Darius put it in the present continuous tense, and he says, he delivered, he delivered, he's delivering now, he'll continue to deliver in Jesus' name. He rescued, he rescued, he's rescuing people now, and he will continue to rescue. And then he tells us, he walks, not that he just walked in the past, yes, he walked in the past, and he's walking now, and he will continue to walk. He walks signs and wonders in heaven and in earth. He tells us there is no area, there is no dominion, whether in the sky, or in the firmament of heaven, or in heaven itself, or on earth, or under the earth, anywhere a miracle working power of God is needed, God does it, because he works signs and wonders in heaven and in earth. Who has delivered Daniel? Because he has this power that abideth forever. And because he has this glory and honor that abideth forever, that's why he delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. We're going to divide the study tonight to three parts. Number one, the attributes of the living God. Not a dead God, not an impotent God, not a God that used to be but is no more. The living God that is still alive today and will be alive forever. He's been alive from all eternity, dateless past, until the future eternity, eternal future, dateless future, because he is the living God. And we're going to look at some of his attributes. Number two, the authority of the living God. He has kingdom, he has dominion, he has power, he has strength, and he has majesty, and everything is under his control. The wind and the waves and the storm and the lions and the bear and everything, every power on earth, you find under the authority and the control of this almighty God. He has authority, the authority of the living God. And then the acts of the living God. You know, there are people, when you think about men, they can do something but they don't. They have the ability, but they don't. They're not willing. But in the case of God, he has the power. And because of the love he has, and because of his mercy, and because of his goodness, and because of his affection, he has compassion, he has love, he has mercy. Because of that, he makes use of his ability to do something in the lives of the people that believe on him. That's how we're going to look at number three, the acts of the living God. Number one, the attributes of the living God. The attributes of the living God. Number two, the authority of the living God. The authority of the living God. Number three, the acts, the actions of the living God. Let's come back to number one. What's number one? The attributes of the living God. Let's come back to Daniel chapter 6, verse 26. The first part of verse 26. Here is what it says. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God. He is who? The living God, and steadfast forever. Now, Darius said, in my kingdom, I stamp out it easy. I wash off, I clean up, I destroy by a decree. That there is no atheism in my kingdom. If he could do that in his whole kingdom, how about you in your own territory? How about you in your family? How about you among the circle of friends that you have? That you say, all around me, you are here, and then you draw a circle around yourself and say, inside the circle of my family, and the circle of my friends, and the circle of the people that know me, all the people that are associated with me, there's not going to be atheism. Atheism is the people that say there's no God. And then Darius said, in my kingdom, in my dominion, anyone around me here on whom I have any control in my jurisdiction, there's nobody that is serving a dead God. There's nobody saying there's no God, because we have seen. And we see it in Daniel. And we know that there is a God in heaven. If there is no God in heaven, look, how about Daniel? How about the preservation? How about the protection? How about the fulfillment of the promise of God upon Daniel? Therefore, he said, all around me here, no atheism. If you can make up your mind that none of your friends will be an atheist. Am I right? None of your people, the people that are close to you, you'll not be, you know, walking hand in hand and walking shoulder to shoulder with somebody who does not believe in this living God. And then you see the God of heaven is the living God. He is the fountain of life. That's what Darius just discovered. He said, the God of Daniel. By the way, you understand the difference between the God of Daniel and the God of Belshazzar and the God of Babylon and the God of this world and the God of whatever. This is different. This is the creator of the heavens and the earth. And this is the living God. He is the fountain of life and is the giver of life. All living creatures derive their lives from him. And we all depend on him. But he himself, the living God, he is independent. That means he can live without you. He can live without the whole world. He had been living without the world before the world was created. And therefore he has independent life, independent power, independent control, independent authority. He is immutable. That means unchangeable. He is infinite. He is eternal. In fact, the Bible says, the word of God says, and we know it, he liveth forever. His existence is from everlasting as well as to everlasting. Is without beginning as well as without end. How mysterious that is. God has life in himself. In fact, that's what Jesus Christ himself, who came from the very bosom of the Heavenly Father. That's what he said in John chapter 5, verse 26. John chapter 5, verse 26. For as the Father has life in himself, so has he given to the Son to have life in himself. That means, you know, in our case, we derive our lives from God. He created us. He made us. He gave us life. But nobody gave him life. He had always been alive from all eternity. He has life in himself. Here Christ himself affirmed that God is the source of all life. As he is the living God. The living God is the eternal King who had been alive before time began. And who will continue to live when time shall be no more. Is immortal and is incorruptible in his essence. He is permanent, he is unchangeable, he is eternal. He is the true God, the living God, the holy God, he is a righteous God, he is a merciful God, he is a faithful God, he is a mighty God, he is eternal God. And that's what Daniel had known all along. That's what gave Daniel faith. When you know the kind of God you serve, when you know the power, the eternality, the infinity of the God yourself, you know the majesty and you know the power, the strength, the highness, the greatness of the God you serve, nothing will terrify you anymore. And he is the God of heaven. He is the God of heaven and earth. He is the God of the whole earth. He is the God of the spirits of all flesh. He is the God of truth, without iniquity, just and right. He is the Lord God of knowledge and the God of glory and the God of peace. And he is the God of patience and consolation and the God of our salvation. You think about this God, he's so great. And that's why Darius said, this is the living God. And we have the proof of it because we have seen the manifestation of his power in Daniel. And I pray that your neighbors will see the manifestation of the greatness, the goodness, and the mercy, and the compassion, and the power of God through your life. Everything I pray to you this year in Jesus' name. And like Darius not believe because of what he saw in Daniel about the Almighty God, I pray that people around you too, they will believe through you in Jesus' name. We're looking at Deuteronomy chapter 32. Deuteronomy chapter 32. Let's listen to the Almighty God himself declaring who he is. Darius had said, he's the living God. What does God say about himself? Look at it in Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 40. For I lift up my hand to heaven and say, I live forever. Think about that. Almighty God himself affirming and confirming and saying, yes, Darius was right. And all the people that know him as a true God, as a faithful God, as the immutable God, unchanging God, and the living God, they are right. Because God himself said, I lift up my hand to heaven and I say, I live forever. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40, and we're reading from verse 28. Here himself, the Lord is asking a question. When you have a problem and you tremble, the Lord is asking you a question. When you have a mountain before you and you're afraid, the Lord is asking you a question. When your body is racked with pain and sickness, and then you begin to shake, tremble, and you become afraid, the Lord is asking you a question. When the princes and the presidents, when they surround you and they say, we'll kill you, we'll destroy you, we'll make a decree that will terminate your life and will terminate your ministry, and then you become afraid, the Lord is asking you a question. When the people of the world, when they gather around and then they say, you think you're going to church, you think you're serving God, we're going to deal with you. And then your knees begin to knock together and you need to breathe very fast as if I'm going to die. The people of the world, they said they are going to deal with me. The Lord is asking you a question. Look at that question in chapter 40 of Isaiah, verse 28. Hast thou not known? Why are you afraid? Why are you intimidated? Why are you shaking? Why are you worried? Why are you anxious? Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. You'll not be afraid again. Because this God is your God. This God is your heavenly Father. And he says, I'll never leave you. I will never forsake you. He says, he'll be with you to the very end. No worry, no anxiety anymore in Jesus' name. He giveth power to the faint. And to them that have no might, he increases strength. Even the youths shall faint. Now, it's talking about the youths that do not know God. The youths that do not have God. But the youths that know God, you will not faint. The youths that know God, you'll not be weary. The youths that know God, you will not fall, you'll not falter, you'll not fail. But those who do not know God, you know, there are storms in life, there are difficulties in life, there are dangers in life. And the people that do not have the Almighty God to help them, what are they going to do in the day of danger, in the day of battle? For us who know God, there is nothing to fear. I said, for us who know God, there is nothing to fear. It says, he giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall, but they that wait upon the Lord shall do what? They shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. When you know this living God, he will be with you. How does somebody know the living God? Because you see, in the case of Darius, he was still doubtful. Daniel, is your God whom you serve continually? Is he able to deliver you from the power of the lions? He didn't know. He wanted to find out. How do you cross from the point of unbelief to the point of faith? That you know, this God, the mighty God, he'll never leave me. He'll never forsake me. And whatever I'm passing through, I'm not going to stay there. I'm going to pass through. And I'm going to come to the other side, the resurrection side. You need to turn away from every other God and turn unto the living God. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. And you're going to find out how we now come to believe in the living God. How the living God becomes our God. And becomes our Lord. And it becomes a Savior. Becomes a Redeemer. And then becomes a stay and a strength of our very lives. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9. For they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we urge unto you. How ye turned, that's a word, mark that word. How ye turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. You see, all men have been sinners. The Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says there is no one righteous, no, not one. The Bible says we have all gone astray. We served the dead God. The gods that be no gods at all. But now when you hear the gospel and the preacher comes to you, like you are hearing the word of God now, and a soul winner, an evangelist comes to you, and the word that he preaches has an entrance into your heart. And then, as a result of that word coming to you, oh, you say, I need to turn. I didn't know this before. I didn't have the light before. I didn't know the way of salvation before, but now I know. And you turn from yourself, and you turn from sin, and you turn from the world. If the world was your God before, that means the world controlled your thoughts, your action, your life, and you were so much afraid whatever the world will say or do because the world was your God. Or maybe self was your God. You idolized self, you exalted self, you worshipped self. And you did everything, you sacrificed to self, but now you turn away from that God. And it was sin. You loved sin so much, you delighted in sin so much, and you ate sin and drank sin and embraced sin, and you just lived your life in sin, and sin was your God. You turn from that God, the dead God, and you turn to the living God. That's what the Thessalonians did. That's how the living. And when there is a persecution, draw near unto God. And when there is something trying to intimidate you, make you afraid, make you panic, and make you tremble, draw nearer unto God. It says, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our body washed with pure water. Let us hold fast. How do we hold what we believe? How do we hold what we believe? Hold it fast. And you know, when you're sick, you're very tender. And when you're sick, it appears what you are holding, you cannot hold it again, and you hold it with a loose hand. If your relatives will come and you will say, how about this? How about this? You say, well, you are my people. Whatever you say, no, you have the final say. I said you have the final say. And if you exercise your authority and your faith, this sin, it comes and it will go. I said it has come, it will go. That's why the Bible says, and it came to pass. It has not come to stay, it has come to pass. It will pass away. I said it will pass away. That's the reason why, whatever the lions are,